was a little boy, I wanted a Barlow knife. Now I want little Shady Grove to say she'll be my wife. Oh, Shady Grove, my little love, Shady Grove, I say, Shady Grove, my little love, I'm bound to go away.
Hello, everyone. When has the name of a knife ever made it into the lyrics of a song? Not very often, I guess. Except for the legendary Bowie knife, perhaps. Shady Grove is a popular American folk song that goes back to the 18th century. According to Wikipedia, over 300 stanzas have been written and added as variations. The fact that the Barlow knife stanza has become part of this American traditional shows that the Barlow knife is deeply rooted in American culture. George Washington is said to have owned a Barlow knife. The iconic status of this American knife will become even more evident when we get to the second part of this video, where I will be taking you on a knife-related journey through Mark Twain's novels The Adventures of Tom Sawyer and The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn. Although the Barlow knife seems to be at the heart of American culture, the origin of this knife is British. It was probably first manufactured by Obadiah Barlow in Sheffield around 1670. His grandson, John Barlow, joined the business around 1745 and he started the exportation of the Barlow knives to America. But very soon the Barlow knife was also made by several American shops. John Russell is said to have been the first American to manufacture Barlow knives. The John Russell Company started to make Barlow knives at their factory in Greenfield, Massachusetts in 1785. Now, what are the characteristics of a Barlow knife? A Barlow-style knife has one or two blades, a teardrop-shaped handle, and a huge metal bolster at the small end of the handle where the blade or blades are attached. This elongated bolster is added for extra strength, of course. Here I've got an inexpensive Rough Rider Barlow with two blades, but the early Barlow knives had only one blade, like this Case Barlow. Before we get to the specs of this knife, let's take a look at the case model number. The leading five stands for stack, the handle material. The next number denotes the number of blades. And 009 is Case Cutlery's pattern number for a Barlow knife. Then we've got a fraction, 1/2. That's Case Cutlery's abbreviation for a clip master blade. The reason for this somewhat unusual abbreviation is that the complete model number has to fit on the tang of the blade. Finally, the suffix SS stands for stainless steel. Now for the specs. The closed length is 3 3/8 inch or 8.6 centimeters. The blade length is 2.4 inches or 6 centimeters. Just for comparison purposes, here is the Victorinox Cadet. Both knives are about the same size, but the construction of the Case Barlow is more rugged. The backspring is pretty strong. By the way, this case knife comes with a half stop and the blade snaps into the half stop position and into the open position very firmly, no blade play. The blade steel is Case Cutlery's True Sharp surgical stainless steel, which can be sharpened to a razor sharp edge. Now for the handle construction. This characteristically long bolster is made of nickel silver. Inside the handle there are two brass liners. But the star here are the stack handle slabs. You have probably already noticed the words prime stack here on the blade. So far this is my only case knife with stack, so I can't compare prime stack to Case's regular stack, but prime stack simply means that Case hand selects only those stack pieces with the most character. And these here are really beautiful. And I'm glad that they didn't put a shield on the handle. Is this knife a collectible or a tool for everyday use? It definitely makes a nice piece in anyone's knife collection, but I wouldn't consider it as a safe queen. Yes, it's more expensive than a case knife with bone handle scales, but all in all, it's still very affordable. So I think you should use this knife, maybe not every day, maybe you carry it only on special occasions, At least that's what I plan to do with this knife. All right, if you were just interested in the knife review, you can stop this video now. In the next part, we will be following the track of the Barlow knife in Mark Twain's two most famous novels. The Barlow knife received a literary memorial from Mark Twain with his novels The Adventures of Tom Sawyer and The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn. When Twain published the books in 1876 and 1884, the Barlow knife had already been around for a long time. It was a must in the pocket of every schoolboy of the 19th century. Being given a Barlow knife used to be a rite of passage for young American boys. Tom Sawyer is an orphan. He doesn't receive his Barlow knife from his father, but from his saintly cousin Mary. In chapter 4, Tom Sawyer is rewarded with the Barlow knife for learning Bible verses. Mary gave him a brand new Barlow knife worth 12.5 cents, and the convulsion of delight that swept his system shook him to his foundations. True, the knife would not cut anything, but it was a sure enough Barlow, and there was inconceivable grandeur in that. Though where the Western boys ever got the idea that such a weapon could possibly be counterfeited to its injury is an imposing mystery and will always remain so, perhaps. 12.5 cents. How much would that be by today's standards? That's very difficult to answer. Mark Twain doesn't tell us when the novel takes place, but a good guess is that the novel is set in 1845. Depending on which historical currency conversion you use, you get very different figures. Based on the buying power, a dollar in 1845 had approximately the same value as 30 current dollars. So the value of Tom's Barlow knife would be $3.75 by today's standards. That would be a very cheap knife, even cheaper than this Rough Rider Barlow. But please keep in mind that the Barlow knives of that time were designed to be tough and to be affordable. To keep the price low, the blade was forged from high carbon steel and the handle was bone, and not much time was spent in polishing or other finishing. But Mark Twain gives us the value of some other things, which allows for a better comparison with this 12.5 cent Barlow knife. For example, the Bible that the pupils of the Sunday school receive for 10 yellow tickets is worth 40 cents. And in chapter 35, Mark Twain lets us know that a dollar and a quarter a week would board, lodge, and school a boy in those old simple days, and clothe him and wash him too, for that matter. But back to Tom's Barlow knife. In chapter 8, Tom settles on becoming a pirate and decides to get his possessions together. He begins by digging under a log where he has placed a box with a marble. And his tool of choice is, of course, his Barlow knife. Yes, it was settled, his career was determined. He would run away from home and enter upon it. He would start the very next morning. Therefore, he must now begin to get ready. He would collect his resources together. He went to a rotten log near at hand and began to dig under one end of it with his Barlow knife. He soon struck wood that sounded hollow. This episode is a kind of prelude to the final episode where Tom and Huck find Injun Joe's treasure. Tom's real Barlow was out at once, and he had not dug 4 inches before he struck wood. Hey Huck, you hear that? I don't want to overinterpret the role of Tom's Barlow knife in the novel, but the fact that Tom is being considered old enough to take care of a real Barlow makes this knife part of Tom's growing up process. And in this respect, Tom's Barlow knife makes an innocent contrast to the other important knife in the novel, Muff Potter's knife, which Injun Joe uses to murder Dr. Robinson. Let's take a quick look at Mark Twain's sequel, The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn. In chapter 9, Huck and Jim explore an island in the Mississippi River. The river is in full flood, and one night Huck and Jim notice a two-story house floating by. They explore the house and find a dead man and all sorts of things, including a Barlow knife. We got an old tin lantern and a butcher knife without any handle and a brand new Barlow knife worth 2 bits in any store. As Tom's knife, the Barlow is brand new, and again, Mark Twain lets us know the value of the knife. A bit is an eighth of a dollar, so Huck's knife is worth 25 cents, which is double the value of Tom's Barlow knife. Huck's Barlow knife doesn't play an important role in the novel, though. So let's turn to another episode, the Bricksville episode. Bricksville is the small town in the novel where Colonel Sherburne kills the town drunk, at which point the rest of the town tries to lynch him. Bricksville is a rundown town, the streets are all mud and the gardens are full of garbage. In chapter 21, Huck, he is the narrator of the novel, Huck gives us a description of Bricksville's main street. All the stores was along one street. They had white domestic awnings in front, and the country people hitched their horses to the awning posts. There was empty dry goods boxes under the awnings, and loafers roosting on them all day long, whittling them with their Barlow knives, and chawing tobacco, and gaping, and yawning, and stretching. A mighty ornery lot. Now you know where the expression whittling away time comes from. But seriously, the Barlow knife was a ubiquitous item in the America of those days. Especially in the Midwest and the South, a large proportion of working men, and if we believe Mark Twain, loafers as well, carried a Barlow knife. I hope you enjoyed this little side trip to Mark Twain, who really immortalized the Barlow knife in his classic novels Tom Sawyer and Huckleberry Finn. I apologize to all my American viewers for butchering Mark Twain's language with my German accent. If anyone wants to experience these great novels in Mark Twain's famous Missouri drawl, I can highly recommend the audiobooks narrated by the actor Richard Hansel. He is known for his one-man stage show, Mark Twain in Person. I have both audiobooks on my iPod, but of course, for copyright reasons, I can't let you listen to them. Sorry for the epic length of this video, I hope you found it interesting. And remember, if you find an old tree with an old carving in the trunk, perhaps it was done with a Barlow knife. Thanks for watching.
Shady Grove, my little love, Shady Grove, I say. Shady Grove, my little love, I'm bound to go away. Cheeks as red as a blooming rose and eyes are the prettiest brown. She's the darling of my heart, sweetest little girl in town. Oh, Shady Grove, my little love, Shady Grove, I say. Shady Grove, my little love, I'm bound to go away. I wish I had a big fine horse and the corn to feed him all, and Shady Grove to stay at home and feed him while I'm gone. Shady Grove, my little love, Shady Grove, I say. Shady Grove, my little love, I'm bound to go away. Went to see my Shady Grove, she's standing in the door. Her shoes and stockings in her hand and a little bare feet on the floor. Shady Grove, my little love, Shady Grove, I say. Shady Grove, my little love, I'm bound to go away. When I was a little boy, I wanted a Barlow knife. Now won't little Shady Grove say she'll be my wife. Oh, Shady Grove, my little love, Shady Grove, I say. Shady Grove, my little love, I'm bound to go away. Kiss from pretty little Shady Grove as sweet as brandy wine, and there ain't no girl in this old world that's prettier than mine. Shady Grove, my little love, Shady Grove, I say.